So the next thing I'm going to talk about is somewhat related, and then I'm going to talk about how to secure your website with SSL. So just a little bit about who I am. As far as tech and IT, I've been an IT consultant for over 10 years, worked for the man before that. I'm primarily a WordPress theme developer, and I started using WordPress in 2009. I founded another meetup, the Seacoast, New Hampshire WordPress meetup, which meets up in Portsmouth every month in 2011. So if you live somewhere between there and here, please get on our site and see, come on up if we do something of interest. I've been speaking at WordCamp since 2014. I think I've done Boston almost every year since then. And I also started a WordPress development agency called Spark Development 2 years ago in 2016. And then just a couple fun things to lighten it up. I'm also a board member of the Portsmouth Halloween Parade. And I'm a caterpillar, I'm a poet. I actually got to read a poem at WordCamp US last year, which was super exciting. And I'm known for my epic sneezes. Yes. Which this place has great acoustics, so you better hope I don't go. So first of all, of course, the question is why to secure your website. So with Jonathan, we talked a lot about this data privacy for visitors. This is, in a sense, somewhat related. It's a much more basic step, and it's not mandated by law, but it is becoming, it is super important. The biggest thing that SSL does, not the biggest thing, the main thing that SSL does is encrypts data that passes between your visitor and your website. So this can be things like credit card numbers, social security numbers, login credentials. It can also be things like your favorite color. It can be things that you maybe feel like aren't that important to be encrypted, but at some point, typically something is, and because we're increasingly going into an age of privacy where it is being regulated, essentially everything that is identifiable to somebody becomes private on some level. So SSL enables that information to pass back and forth without being able to be essentially spied on or sniffed on by somebody who's just sitting in the same cafe as you. Because normally the data sent between browsers is plain text. So, like I said, you can literally, if you're not having SSL on your site, even if you're just logging in and you're at your local coffee house, if there's somebody there who's, you know, got a packet sniffer there, they can watch that data go back and forth, and it's not that hard for them to figure out what's going on. And when you are secure, your browser is going to give this nice, reassuring green padlock that we're all getting a little more used to seeing. So as visitors see more and more of that, even if you don't think you have any data that should be secure, visitors are going to start getting used to seeing that, and your site is could possibly suffer without that. Now, on that same vein, Google has basically cornered us into this as well, or pushed us in the right direction at least, because they indicated several years ago that they would start giving preference to sites that have SSL in the same way that they've said they'll give preference to sites that have a mobile experience that's friendly. And they've been phasing in, and apparently as of July of this year, their Chrome browser will start marking all insecure websites as insecure. So the thing about that is that right now they're kind of insecure, but it's not a big deal. But if Google starts marking them as insecure, as opposed to just kind of, I'm not sure what the term is for it, they've kind of been passively marked as insecure at this point, but the impression I get is they're going to be a little more visibly marked as not secure. So people are going to be starting to notice it more, and that's obviously going to be uncomfortable if your site isn't secure and your competitor's site is. So what is SSL? SSL is essentially, stands for Secure Sockets Layer. That's pretty boring. It's essentially a protocol of how to transmit information, usually between a website and a browser. It can also be between a mail server and a client. It is, what I mean by protocol is HTTP is also a protocol. A protocol is basically a language that machines use to go back and forth where they expect data in a certain structure and they pass the information. So when you visit a browser and you visit an HTTP, your browser and the web server know to expect and send the information in a certain way so that the browser knows how to unpack your page, load all of the scripts, make it display right. SSL is similar in that it's another protocol, essentially another machine language that uses that allows these super articulate today, that allows this machine and your browser to communicate back and forth. Funny thing about the SSL version, it, like most software, it has increased in version number as it's gone up. So we had SSL 1, we had SSL 2, we had SSL 3, and for some reason when we went to SSL 4, or what would have been SSL 4, the next version, they decided to rename it to TLS 1.0. So technically we're using TLS 1.2 right now. That is the actual protocol that we're using, but we've continued to use SSL as the generic term. So if you are doing research on a certificate and trying to get a certificate, and you're alarmed that it says TLS instead, that is the current protocol, and again, SSL has just become this umbrella term that we use. So all browsers already know how to communicate using SSL. They essentially understand that language. And once you put an SSL certificate on your site, though, that is what enables your particular website to talk to the browser. The SSL certificate you get consists of a pair of keys, a public and a private key. So if you've ever done anything like PGP encryption or created SSH keys to communicate with a website, an SSL certificate is just like that. It's a pair of keys, one public, one private, that it uses to encrypt the data, be sent, then your browser knows how to unpack the data. And the certificate, in addition to these keys, contains what's called the subject, which is the name of your website. It identifies the name of the certificate owner. So SSL certificates are pretty easy to get these days. I would say 99%, probably all web hosts have them installed for you, not installed for you, but available for you. Whether or not they have free ones is another story, but web hosting providers typically provide them. They used to all be premium. Let's Encrypt started a few years ago, and that's been a major initiative which a number of companies, including Automattic, have gotten behind, and they've essentially made certificates free in an attempt to spread security on the web. So a lot of big name web host providers offer either a free certificate or specifically a Let's Encrypt certificate for websites, but there are a number of third-party websites that I've listed a few of here, and you can even have a self-signed certificate. That's not going to be, that's going to be just as secure as far as the data going back and forth, but it's not going to provide the same kind of verification or validation of who you actually are for your website. So to expand on that a little bit more, when you put SSL on your website, it's securing the data back and forth, but it depends if you have if you have data on your site that is perhaps more confidential in nature or is in more need of being encrypted, like you are having credit card numbers or you are having personal health information, social security number, something more than favorite color, you can, instead of getting a free certificate, you can essentially buy an SSL certificate that has a little more oomph behind it. It usually has a higher rate of encryption, and you can buy ones that include essentially a verification process where you don't just buy it and click it and go. You buy it, but it goes through a process where they actually contact your business, look up the address, call somebody, and essentially verify that you're really who you say you are. So for instance, if you probably, I'm imagining a lot of you do online banking, when you go to your online bank, you probably see more than a green padlock. You probably see something that specifically has the name of your institution. So because they deal with such more confidential information than a lot of websites, they have a much more secure SSL. But at its basics, having an SSL is going to secure the information back and forth. It's going to be incredibly safe. Most of us, a Let's Encrypt SSL is completely fine. It's going to cover us. If you have more complex security needs or more sensitive data, then you probably do want to investigate one of these other certificates. Installing the SSL certificate is usually fairly simple. It depends on the host. They're all a little bit different. Every host out there, though, should help you with that. You're a paying customer. They will have instructions on their knowledge base. If you get stuck, they will help you. Some of them you have to actually have them install it themselves if you buy it from somewhere else. So sometimes you can install it yourself, sometimes you can't. The process is a little bit different. A lot of the major sites right now who have the Let's Encrypt certificates have a little thing where you can just click and go. The only thing to note about the Let's Encrypt certificates versus the other ones is that most SSL certificates last a year. Let's Encrypt certificates only last 90 days. But most websites that offer, most web hosting providers that offer them will auto-renew them for you. So once you set it up and install it, yes, it technically expires after 90 days, but your web host should be refreshing it every 90 days. I have occasionally had problems with sites, though, with some web hosting providers who I will not name, since one of them is here, where there's occasionally trouble. So you do have to kind of keep an eye on it. I've heard a couple instances lately of them not being renewed, the Let's Encrypt, but typically they should be, and if you do run into a problem where it's not renewing, just call your web host. They probably had a glitch in the system. They can reset it for you. So once you get the SSL certificate on, that obviously is great, but that's really not the whole story. You still have to do a little more to make your site completely secure. These are the four basic steps, and we'll go through them in a little more detail. But first of all, you obviously need to change your site URL to use the HTTPS. So right in your settings screen where you tell WordPress what the URL for your site is, you need to switch it over to HTTPS so it knows to use that everywhere in reference to itself. You also want to modify your htaccess file if you're on an Apache server. If you're on a Windows server, I think it's the webconfig file. The process varies a little bit. A lot of websites use Apache, so I'm going to focus on the htaccess, but it's a similar process. The modifying of that is two things. One, to do the 301 redirect so that if people visit the non-SSL page, they will be redirected to the SSL page. And it's also to keep them from being able to access that non-SSL page. Google considers HTTP and HTTPS different websites. So if you have content, if you secure your website but you still can access your website without using HTTPS, Google may look at your site and say that you've got duplicate content and penalize you because it thinks you're trying to put the same content on two different websites. So once you put SSL in place, that second step is to make sure everybody goes to the SSL version. You want to do a search and replace to update all of the URLs in your system to use HTTPS. Now, if you did step two right, obviously if they access a non-secure URL, it will get forwarded, but it can still cause issues. You still need them all to be pointing to, you want them all to be pointed uniformly to the SSL. Even if they were to get, even if the htaccess will essentially forward them later, just think about it for consistency. So down the road, if you go to like update your URLs because you changed the structure and you've got half SSL and half not SSL, it's going to cause a problem down the road if you try to update them. And the other thing is that a lot of pages aren't going to work if you still have a mix of those URLs there. So you want to just move everything over, make sure you're consistent through your whole website. And then once you've done these steps, obviously you need to go and actually check your site and see, is it actually showing the padlock? Is it reflecting that it's secure? So step one, fairly straightforward. This is your settings general screen, and that's all I mean there. You just need to go and put in the HTTPS so that WordPress knows that that is your new URL. Your htaccess, this is a code snippet that you can use. There are other ways to write this code snippet, so if you're looking for this at some point and you find something and it doesn't match exactly what I have here, don't worry, htaccess statements can be written in a number of ways, but this will work in that it will forward you every URL that gets visited on your website with the HTTP on your website will automatically forward it to the HTTPS, and it includes the 301. It includes the 301 here, which is what tells Google when Google comes that this is a permanent redirect, but that this is the same page. And therefore, any SEO juice that you've accumulated on your pages for the content that you've posted, Google will carry that over. So if you weren't doing this 301 redirect, Google would take your HTTPS site and be like, oh, it's a whole new site. Let's put them at the bottom of the list. But By putting in the 301 redirect, you are telling Google, hey, don't worry, it's just me still. I'm still just as authoritative a source as you know, had before. So that's how you keep that. If you're not comfortable editing this file, because it can be a little scary, and if you're not comfortable using FTP, you're not a developer, there are some plugins that will do this for you. So WP-Force SSL or Really Simple SSL are two that will do that for you. And I'll post these slides, and those actually link to them, to those plugins. The search and replace, also a couple ways you can do this, at least a couple. I like the Better Search Replace plugin. I believe it's from Delicious Brains, but that's a plugin that you can install on your site and do the search and replace right from the WordPress admin. And it has a very nice dry run feature, so you can run it the first time. It'll tell you how many changes it found, what tables it found those changes in, and then you can run it again. The other option is there's a script, well, one of the other options, there's a script from Interconnected, and they have basically a script that you can download and upload on your server and run, and it does something similar. It's what I used to use before I discovered the Better Search and Replace plugin, but honestly, I find this plugin is really great. It's very easy to use. You can select however many tables you want, so by default it comes in and you have to go and select all the tables. And then the only option that might seem confusing is the leave replace GUID unchecked. And a GUID within WordPress is a unique identifier for the record, and it happens to include the URL of your site. It doesn't really matter that field is updated, because it's literally just a unique identifier behind the scenes. Typically, you want to actually leave it unchecked, and the reason is that if your site has a lot of posts that people may be accessing using RSS readers, that unique identifier is what those RSS readers are using to know if your new content is new or not. So if you go and update them all, then everyone who's subscribed to your site through an RSS reader is going to see all of your site content as new again. So typically you just want to leave them. So it might seem weird to be like, oh no, don't replace them here, but that's the reason why. You don't need to replace them because the URL in those cases is literally just part of a unique identifier that's a one-time value stored. So when you do these updates, it'll tell you what tables. You're typically going to see the most updates in your post table and your post meta table, also the options table. But depending on what plugins you have installed, you might see them in a bunch of other places. You might see them in security plugins. If you're running something like Gravity Forms or another form plugin, you might see them in there. So it's a matter of, if you do the dry run, you can kind of look at it, see if that seems right. You know, if it comes back and says it only had three hits found, then possibly you made a typo. If you see a bunch of hits, you know, in your post table and you have a bunch of content, great. Don't be alarmed by the fact that you'll see many more changes in your post table than you have posts. Because the post table in WordPress is actually used to store a whole slew of things. So it stores posts, it stores revisions of posts that you make, it stores things for your media library, it stores menu items, it's called posts, but it stores really the bulk of the data within WordPress. So you should see a lot of records there. Don't be alarmed by the fact that it'll seem like many times more than you think you have data, because it'll be, it's got everything in there. And then checking the site pages, this is the thing about doing SSL. If you put in SSL and you don't have everything flipped over, it's worse than not having SSL on your site, because Google will tell people that your site is insecure, which of course is what they're going to start doing in July anyway. But if your page includes secure and insecure content, then Google or whatever browser you're using will flag it and basically say, hey, you've got mixed content here, there's a problem. So that's the whole thing about why you want to do the search and replace, why you need to go through. You need everything, not links to external sites. So if you have a picture on your site and it's linking to some other site that doesn't use SSL, that's fine. What I'm talking about is scripts that are being used in the background. So plugins are bringing in like CSS files. When you're linking in images, so you might be just having like a logo image or some kind of decorator image. If that's not also using SSL, that's where you start to get this warning. And it's important to check all over your site, because your homepage is great, but there are all the other pages of your site. You want to kind of browse around to all of your pages and see if you get that padlock. So tips and tricks for finding the securing the content. Obviously, check the browser icon, click on a bunch of pages. If you are not seeing that you're secure, if you have that broken padlock, there's a great website called whynopadlock.com, and you can put your URL right into that, and it will give you a full report. It will tell you whether it could access the non-secure version. It will tell you specifically what resources on your page. I had an agency, and they always had a little footer image in their sites that they launched, and it was the logo of their agency. Well, it was before we started doing SSL everywhere, so every site that they had, of course, used HTTP to reference that logo. So pretty much every time we put a site to SSL, I would know, like, oh, we have to go update, you know, where this logo is. But the WhyNoPadlock will give you a report of everything like that, and it'll just help speed up the process. There are a few plugins that you can use that I've linked here that will essentially fix it for you. They will take those strings and convert them to HTTPS if they're not there. You can look on the source of your page and search for HTTP:// and see if anything comes up. If you have a custom theme, you might actually need to do that search in your theme files, because you might find hard-coded URLs, particularly like in your CSS files. Sometimes if you have a CSS file, somebody includes a background image in the CSS and they don't use a relative path, they hard-code the whole URL, then if when they did it, you weren't on HTTPS, then you might have the wrong URL. One of the things that you can do too is if you have control over that code and you need to go in there and edit it, one of the things you can do is take off the HTTP. So you can actually just start it with the two forward slashes. And that's great if you're like maybe working on a site where maybe on the dev server it's not SSL, but you know when you go live it is going to be SSL. You know, you can go ahead and take the protocol off, and then the browser will just assume it's the same protocol that you have. You're not always able to do that, but I just mentioned it's another way to do it. And obviously, inside your theme code, if you're writing custom theme code, you shouldn't be hard-coding the URL. You should be using the home_URL function to bring in the current site URL. But usually in a CSS file, that's not as easy to do. In a CSS file, I'd recommend a relative path if you can. But I do see plenty of sites where I have the whole URL hard-coded. So once you do that, of course, then you also need to make sure you're telling Google or other third-party services about the change. Google Analytics makes it pretty easy. You can go and just change it in there to HTTPS, tell Google, they'll know that. Google Search Console's a little bit different. They actually don't let you change the URL of the property, so you have to actually add it as a new property with the HTTPS, which means, unfortunately, you have to go through the verification step, where you drop the little file on the server again. But then you probably want to resubmit your sitemap. So it's a little more of a pain with Google Search Console, but it is pretty straightforward, and you do want to go ahead and do it. Bing and Yahoo, I'm not exactly sure what their processes are, but you want to go and check them as well if you've submitted your sitemap there. It might just be a matter of resubmitting your new sitemap so that they know about the pages. One thing to watch out for, when you are ordering your certificate, it's not an issue on a site, on a server, usually where they're ordering it for you, but if you're ordering it from a third party, you need to make sure that you are using the exact same name, and by name I mean domain name, that you're using on your server. So what I mean by this is that if you use, for instance, if you use www.amandagiles.com versus amandagiles.com, Google does not think that those are the same site. They sound the same. We know if you type in, you know, something without the www, often you'll still get to it. Google doesn't think that that's true, because you can have as many subdomains as you want. So they could be different sites. And so when you get a certificate, if you're getting from a third party, make sure that you get it to match your domain name exactly. If you have a number of subdomains, maybe you have a main site and you have a blog dot, your site, a store dot, and your site, something like that. Each of those subdomains either needs their own certificate, or you can put what's called a wildcard SSL on your server, and that if you're paying for it, I think it usually costs a little more money. It's a little more complicated to set up. but it will cover all of your subdomains. Some of the web hosts I know will just do that for you. I think SiteGround will just install a wildcard SSL for you if you ask them on their GoGeek plan. So if you know you're going to have a lot of subdomains, you tend to do a lot of, maybe you do a lot of client sites and they're all subdomained based on your name, you might want to just get one of those so you don't have to add it every time. But again, just make sure that they match, because if they don't, then it won't tag it. It'll essentially flag as an invalid certificate for the wrong site. People who visit your site will get a notice saying, hey, we're not sure about the site. They aren't who they say they are. So easy to avoid if you know. And that's all I've got for you. So. But I'm happy to take questions. People have questions about the SSL or the process. No, all of the plugins that I linked, the question was whether they were premium plugins. All the plugins that I linked here were free. Yep. So in the repository. Yep.
What's your opinion about using something like a simple SSL versus just doing a direct response? Is it one, is it really 6 months or does it the other, or is using a plugin more efficient?
I think it's your comfort level. I mean, my opinion is if you can do it without a plugin, then that's just one less. It's one less piece of overhead on your site. It's one less pain point where something might cause a conflict at some point. On the other hand, if you're not comfortable like going into your htaccess, then I think a plugin is a fine solution. So yeah. Yeah. So the question is, if you're marking a URL under Google Stock Search Console of a 404,
a redirect. 404 error.
Yep.
The one that works.
The one that works.
So there is an option that you can take the option as fixed so that you make a URL, Google Search Console has it as fixed as opposed to.
So the question is whether you would mark it as fixed when you're in there?
Yep.
I can't answer that just because I'm not really considering myself a search expert. Maura, do you have that opinion on that? No. So the question was, if you're in Google Search Console and you have a 404 that you end up redirecting, would you mark it fixed? I think you would if you have the redirect in place and it's happening. I think you would, but
you would.
I believe so, but I think it was not my specialty. So.
I would think that Google overcome would need to assess that.
Well, I think if you don't fix it, though, doesn't it hang around until you kind of resolved it? No? I don't know. I don't use Google Search Console very much, so that's where I call an expert. Anybody else? What's the guy in the bathroom?
Yeah, do you know if there's still this sort of performance penalty that you just come along with establishing new self-connections? You know, like if you have a page with a lot of Ajax calls and maybe it's calling one of the pages, I know that in the past I was concerned that if they were all on the HTTPS side, could really have, especially with people maybe, you know, parts of the world where they don't have, you know, the same sort of password. Do you know if that's something that you've
done? So the question is if you're making a bunch of HTTPS calls, essentially, is that more costly? Is that what you're...
More costly in terms of page loading.
Well, so I don't think it specifically has to do with SSL, but if you're making more page calls, it certainly does cause a problem. Under HTTP and HTTPS, you are limited to, I think it's 6 connections per server at a time. So basically, if you load your page and you're pulling in every JavaScript or CSS separately, all of those multiple hits, it basically can only ask for 6 of them at a time. If you go to HTTPS, that doesn't change right away, but there's a new HTTP2 protocol, which does not have that per that connection limit, and you can't go to it unless you use HTTPS. So going to HTTPS would basically be the first step to then being on a web server that's supporting HTTP2, which actually gets rid of that whole, that current conundrum. So the whole reason we like concatenate files and everything so that we have fewer of those calls. So essentially HTTPS is going to be step one to moving past that, because once you use HTTPS, you can go to HTTP2. But yeah, it is expensive. I mean, if you're doing an Ajax, usually that's quicker because you're only pulling a limited amount of data, but it is still, you know, every connection is
bad. It sounds like you really don't have a choice anymore.
Yeah, I mean, Google is making it hard, and it's honestly, I think for a while, for a lot of us, it was like, yeah, I don't need SSL, I'm not collecting any information, all I have is a contact form. And they're just kind of making it harder and harder to do that. And honestly, given everything that's happening with GDPR, I just think it makes sense, even if it doesn't feel like confidential data. I mean, even if you do a website for a doctor's office and you have a contact us form, somebody could put, you know, personal information in there, and people are just becoming more and more conscious of it. And Google, like I said, is they're kind of applying the thumb, so they're going to make you look bad if you don't do it at this point. And hopefully what you've gotten from this is that it's not that hard. You know, I do this for clients and it's typically under an hour to go through the steps and check everything. Every once in a while there's something that's like I have to hunt down, like there's some pesky graphic somewhere that's hard-coded. But, you know, usually it goes pretty smoothly. And worth it. So. Great. Get a new host. As plain text, and you can install them. And sometimes I think there's a little more than that, but sometimes it's you just paste those in. You know, usually I try to follow the steps, and if it doesn't work, then I ask the support. And honestly, if you're paying for support, they should help you. And even sites, even I mentioned, like I've had trouble with a couple. I had a couple of sites recently where the Let's Encrypt. I'm not even sure it was Let's Encrypt actually. The free SSL offered by the host was not getting auto-renewed. And I still just had to get on with them and say, hey, it's not being auto-renewed. And then actually one time they fixed that. And then my site was showing a completely different site. It was like, oh yeah, now it's secure, but it says like, à tout bien. And it's supposed to say, you know, New Hampshire Boat Museum. So, you know, I stayed on chat and they figured out basically they were reusing an SSL and they put one from a different server or a different site that was on the same server and they fixed it. You know, so it's not, it's their job. And if they're not providing good support on that, I would definitely look for any host. Sensitive data, a free SSL certificate, I think, is plenty of encryption. I'll cop John, though, and be like, I'm also not a lawyer. But, you know, it will encrypt data just the same, maybe not at the same as high a key, and it won't have the verification piece. It's still encrypting the data, though. And every web host out there, they should want that, so if they're not being helpful. I'm pretty sure A2 just has a click thing where you can go. I know SiteGround does. Bluehost site does as well. Yep, thumbs up back there.
1-1 does not allow Let's Encrypt. 1-1 does not allow Let's Encrypt. At this time.
Yep.
I already have that
flag. Alright, anyone else? Yep.
Well, someone commented where you don't always have a certificate, or your certificate say you're encrypted between them and the user, but sometimes they allow you not to be encrypted with your own medical.
I'm not sure. I think my thought at that point is call support.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm coming in more from a developer perspective, so I will say I'm not a network expert, but I put a lot of SSL certificates on. And pretty much I'm like, if I get everyone over my head, support team, that's what they're there for. Sometimes it has to be a different kind of certificate, you know, if you're working with a third-party service. But they should know, and they should be able to, you know, you shouldn't have to understand all of how it works if you're paying for the service. Great. Well, this is where you can find me online, my website, Twitter, ManageSNH. I'll see you at WordCamp Boston.
Yeah.
I think I bumped it once, but at the end I know I smacked it. But.
There's still more pizza, there's still more cake.